Well, I was going to do a Super Bowl special so you'd have an alternative to watching the Super Bowl, but I got hit with an insight this morning, fortunately, that was so strong that I'm almost speechless, really. I don't know what to say exactly. It's sort of like everything just snapped together. So all the parts are familiar, but the fact that it all held together and snapped together is like, what? It's kind of like you're trying to solve one of those jigsaw puzzles, and you've been trying, what, you know, you see all the pieces and then suddenly it fits together and boom, there's the picture. It's like, oh my gosh, so that's it. Yeah, and it's a very great experience to have, actually. So I'm just kind of, it's like about a couple hours ago maybe that I had it, and so I'm just reverberating from that. So I don't know how well I can, what I can say, but I'll try, at least I'll try to say something, I don't know what. I can say what happens when you see that it all snaps together, as far as, wow, so this is the problem. What I saw was, well, a total situation, but part of that, totality of the picture is seeing, why did I get seduced into coming into this world in the first place? That's been a question in my mind my whole life, and I finally found out why. And it's not a pretty picture at all. It's terrible. Just total deceit, you know. It's just basically simply as a foil for half-truthness. You see, in order to promote the notion of half-truths, you need someone, you need a foil to play the role of truth. So then you can say, oh good, here's truth, and now we're going to add on lies, and then we're going to have the finished product, which is going to be half-truth. So you have to have those who will come in and play the role of truth here in this world. And that's what I got suckered into. How do you get suckered into anything like that so terrible? Well, it gets back to music, I tell you. I have a relative who's a musical genius. A rare musical genius. And the truth is, though, that he was so incredibly smart, but he had his Achilles heel was music, and he got suckered into really just a dead-end life because he would not evaluate the cost. If someone could tell him, look, I want you to do this for me, and he'd say, well, I don't know about that. And they said, but we'll arrange for a little concert that you can play and we'll come and listen. And he'd say, oh, okay. He was blind to evaluating, you know, what's the downside? If he had an opportunity for someone to listen to him play music and sing, etc., he would accept any deal whatsoever. And there is the problem. So, not counting the cost at all, if it involves music, is a severe problem for musicians. And unfortunately, I happen to have been a musician in a previous life. And I was used to audiences listening to my music. And so what happened was, I was told, if you come into the world and you can bring truth into the world, and also, you know, you get to do it musically, you know, and so I didn't count the cost. I said, oh, really? I mean, people will listen to my music? And yeah, oh, okay. Didn't count the cost. That's the musician's downfall. Musicians are among the most stupid people there are, because they have this severe blindness. I've seen it firsthand. Gosh, my relative was just something else. I mean, he'd go into hell if he could have one person listen to him play, you know, his music. He wouldn't count the cost. Oh, okay, I have a concert. Okay, let's go. Wait a minute, this is hell. Yeah, oh, okay, well, anyway, someone's gonna listen to me, so it's no big deal. This is great. and so this place is hell, actually. This world is hell. It's the hellish kingdom of half-truths, trying to establish half-truths as greater than truth, as the new reality. And I didn't count the cost properly. Yeah, so I got suckered into coming into this world. That is a fact. And I paid the most unbelievably bad price for that. because I'm willing to just say, well, I'll keep on going, as long as they have this carrot, you know, ahead of you, thinking like, maybe someday I'll be able to compose some great music and help the world and move towards truth and all this kind of stuff. Meanwhile, you're getting more and more and more enmeshed in the diabolical game of half-truths, where you're just a foil. Just a foil. That's the truth. That those who come in this world to spread truth are just foils for lies to be added unto them. So the ego can say, here is your half-truth. Part truth, part lie. How can you have part truth and part lie if you don't have some people in the world who represent truth, and then those who represent lies, and then the ego saying, let's put them together, and there's your half-truth. It's like a cat and mouse. The cat wants a mouse to play with. And you get suckered into coming into this world. And that's what happened to me. Absolutely, it's happened to a lot of people. There are a lot of spiritual teachers are exactly that way. I don't want to name names. The only legitimate ones are the ones that the avatars who come in who purely for the upliftment of truth, that they're not playing that game at all. They're beyond that. They've seen through the whole thing. But the rest of us are actually foils to come into this world. I've always said the best cure for this world is don't come here in the first place. Really. That's the goal. Don't come here in the first place. So finally, I've seen through it. I've seen through the whole thing. So it's a great liberation, actually, because it's very unlikely I'll be ever coming back to this place unless it's in the role of a truly enlightened being that is not coming in to be a foil for half-truths at all and is able to dispel that whole paradigm. So it's a great day to see that, actually. Tremendous, but it is painful, because you realize that your whole life is you've been deceived, and you just were here as a foil for the ego to use you to amalgamate with lies, and then say here's a half truth. See, oh, the ego says, look at this world, it's great. We got people here speaking truth, we got people speaking lies, and we're able then to join together. Let's all get along. All is one. We join together as one, and we have this kingdom of half truths. And the ego says, how can we have a kingdom of half truth if we don't have people here speaking truth? But those speaking truth were suckered into coming here just to be a foil for the ego. You see, leave the coming into this world for the true avatars, the great saviors. Leave it for them to do it. That's the truth. Don't come here. You're going to be just played for a fool by the ego. And absolutely, that's exactly what's happened to my entire life. Life of really imprisonment and torture in this role of just being just a foil. That's all. The world's not interested in anything I have to say. The world is interested in how the ego can combine truth and lies. That's what the world's interested in. And so, you know, you need to have a great mood of repentance, a great clarity, to be able to handle this kind of insight. Otherwise, it's going to wipe you out. You know, you're just going to be devastated by it. Just devastated. And again, I was, you know, pulled into this world through the use of opportunity for music. Otherwise, I would have seen through the situation, but I had this blindness, very much so. Like, I mean, I came into the world in this incredibly musical time, the 60s, you know, the late 50s, early 60s was probably the best musical time this world's ever seen. And then it grew and grew through the 60s and the 70s, you know, it was just incredible. I couldn't resist it. You know, the opportunity, I thought, wow, I'm going to be like a superstar, musical superstar, and I'm going to turn the music towards spiritual, religious, truth music, that people then would be able to get with it. And the opportunity was incredible, and I couldn't pass it up. Not, you know, paying attention to, I'm sure, my mentor saying, hey, you know, that's a big mistake. Don't make the mistake. You're just being played. You're being played for a fool by the ego. And they turned out to be right. So it's a great blessing to be able to actually see this finally. I've never been able to see this before, and it's always been, why did I come into this world? How did I get tricked? You know, what's the big, wow. It's a heavy, heavy insight for sure. You know, in one regard, almost devastating, but I'm not experiencing that way. I'm just sort of feeling a heavy heart, you know, like, wow, what a diabolical dream this is, really. Again, and yesterday seeing the half-truths thing and working through the half-truths, all that getting clear, led to this breakthrough, finally realizing, how did I get suckered into coming in this world in the first place? So I say to all musicians, you know, I'm trying to help them out. because they have this super blind spot. And there's no question that musicians are getting used brutally, always have in this world. Artists, have gotten just used brutally by the ego in this world. Do not sacrifice truth for the sake of art. That is the huge mistake, and you pay a horrible price for that, actually. You get used to death, you know, to try and set a soundtrack to this half-truth world, you know, this half-truth domain. At least the effort to, you know, can sell that half-truths or some superior new reality, and we're so blessed, you know, to be living in such a domain. So it's been a, you know, rough couple hours, but nothing like I haven't been through many, many times with every other, you know, heavy insight. This is the heaviest of all, for sure, because you see, your life has been nothing but you've been completely deceived. You've wasted your life. You wasted coming here. It's a total mistake to come here in the first place. And really, there's not much you can do in this world, actually. I've seen even some of the top gurus in this world, they're just foils for the ego. They're just foils. The ego's just using them. They're saying, hey, everybody, look, we have truth in the world. Everyone, and then let's combine the truth and the lies, and we're going to succeed. And everybody's saying, great. You know, they're happy. Oh, yeah, nice, guru, wonderful. Glad you're here. As a part of the half-truthness. And I've even seen some of these top gurus being confused and perplexed by this. Like, what the heck's going on here? They don't really see it, tell you the truth. They don't. They're perplexed. I can see the perplexity, like, frustration, perplexity, like, how come people are not getting this? How come they're not listening to me? You know, because they wanted to come in here and play the role of a guru. And they got suckered into it. That's a fact. Even some of the top gurus in this world, they got suckered into this world. Again, leave the coming into this world to the genuine avatars and saviors, the real heavyweights. The rest of us, hands off, absolutely. Don't come in to play the guru, don't come in to play music, or don't come in to play a musical guru, or any combination thereof. So I don't know what the future holds for me at all. I really don't at this point. Very difficult to... I'm sure I'll see it, you know, it'll come along. Now there's a natural stratification. Nature is a pressure continuum. It's all based on pressure. And it's inevitable that stratification takes place in nature because pressure stratify. So in this world, there is going to be stratification take place, the way I see it, between those who are still devoted to trying to make half-truths the new reality and those who are ready to give it up. A stratification is going to take place. Probably very soon. That's probably why I finally saw through this insight, like, wow, this opens the door to stratification for me. I'm going to be able to do it, recognizing that I was just played for a fool here. There's no question about it. So stratification, I call it relocation. People call it ascension. They call it rapture. They call it all these things. It's really just a stratification. If you look at it that way, it's a lot easier. It's just nature stratifying. The greater nature, just there's a stratification state. This just automatically takes place. And we're probably on the cusp of that stratification taking place. So once this thing all sets in and works through, I'll be in good humor about it. I am in good humor already about it. But it's still, you know, it's like, wow. And then I've seen, and now I'm aware of people, how they're just so completely caught up in this half-truth thing and all the deceit that they use to cover it up, and how they just use you. They just, you know, just absolutely use you. And they throw water on your fire of your aspiration. There's going to be my gigantic water on our aspiration thing take place in this world, which is why stratification is also likely to take place. It's an attempt to then establish half-truths. It's a done deal. It's all baked, and here it is. And all this, so all those who play the role of truth and those who play the role of lies, boom, gone. And in this place, now those who simply are abiding in this realm of half-truth. It's a whole different, it's the fourth dimensionals, really. So the third dimensional is gone, the fifth dimensional is gone. Stratification, fourth dimensional is here. Those who believe that they're abiding in this new realm, new reality of half-truths. But of course, nobody likes to be played for a fool. But we are on a grand scale being played for fools, on a grand scale. And that's, waking up to that is like, wow, it's kind of like you have a nightmare and you start waking up from it, and then you're aware of the nightmare, like, oh my gosh, that's a very, very nasty nightmare, for sure. And kind of lingers, you know, lingers on a little bit here. Yeah, shocking, shocking thing, but I'm seeing it. It's something that's always perplexed me. I say, you know what? All these spiritual teachers here, there's something that isn't quite right. And I've been puzzling over for so long, and now I see what it is. They're just being played for fools, patsies. They think they're helping out, but that's not really the case, actually. Because, again, they're just here to provide the truth aspect of a half-truth. That's what they're being used for. They're being used by the ego, actually. They think they're succeeding. No, they're being used by the ego. Just being used by the ego. That's what I've seen now. That the scope of our deception is greater than we realize, actually. It all has to do with half-truths, which all have to do with fear of the continuity issue. So you can boil it down again. The way out is to accept the continuity issue for yourself and say, I'm going to stick with this problem. I'm going to give away the rest and just stick with this one problem, the continuity issue. And then so you still have potential for problematicalness, informedness, etc. But it's all one smoothed out oneness. And so that solves the continuity problem. That is how to get out of this diabolical situation. It's really very diabolical. Really very diabolical. And all centers on half-truths, right? In level confusion, saying that blending truth and lies gives us a new reality and it's superior to reality. That is what we believe in and what we've been following. So it's not enough to just be a guru telling truth. You have to be aware of the full scope of the deception. And there's something, you know, beyond awareness and clarity that goes deeper than we realize. And how this whole thing is resolved. Now, what I say, you have to break the spell, lessen the spell at higher levels. The people here, what I've seen is they're overwhelmed. They're not succeeding. They're overwhelmed by the deception here. And they're not able to break the spell here. So really working at it at a deeper, more subtle level is better, I would say. Don't bother coming into this world because people don't get it. They don't get it. Leave the coming into this world for the avatars and then focus on the subtler realms where the teaching is it's easier to dispel what's going on. Easier to lessen the duplicity, you know, to break the spell. And probably, you know, help those in the world more than if you came into the world. Where you just played for a patsy, really. You know, don't actually get real traction here. Even the great avatars and saviors don't get much traction here. Very little. Very little. Jesus said, you don't understand what I'm talking about really at all. They're very, very cloudy and fuzzy on it. And then on to my Ma said that very few people came to her actually who had a genuine thirst for truth. Very few. So very little traction, even for the greatest of the greatest, perfectly clear, perfectly free of not even the slightest trace of delusion. Even they get very little traction here. And I've heard a lot of top, you know, really great gurus say that actually better work is done in other realms rather than this realm. And the way you get liberated from this realm is to realize, don't come here. That you're going to be played for a fool in the half-truth game. So seeing that the game is all about half-truths and level confusion being disguised as a quest for half-truth and success being failure being disguised as success towards establishing half-truth It is just an incredible delusion that the world is under. And that can be dispelled. I've been able to dispel it to a large extent. But he is going to make such efforts. It's ridiculous how much efforts I had to make. And the suffering I had to go through is just complete. I don't advise it for anybody to just, it's just I was in got so much help in such a situation where I was basically suffering so terrible. I just had an interest in that to say, well, this is very interesting, how terrible this is. And was able to somehow keep going. But for most people leading their lives here, it's overwhelming. They're not going to want to deal with that at all. No way. So there does need to be help in subtler ways, indirect ways that people in this world are not necessarily aware of. It's a bigger chess game. It's a bigger chess game than we're aware of. That is for sure. So I don't really know what to do next. It's not at all clear. But just continue on in the mood of repentance is the most important thing, which enables this insight to be seen in the first place. Just continue on with the continuity, focusing, accepting the continuity issue as your one and only problem. That is really the key, really, if I see it, the absolute key to success. It has been tremendously, rapidly successful for me. But again, you don't have rapid success until you have a mood of repentance, because the insights that come are very heavy insights. And you have to know how to be able to handle really heavy insights. Genuinely, not intellectually, but actually have an overall attitude and mood and discipline.
Hi, Ross, are you out there?
1 minute, please. What happens, the difficulty is that you see how you're being used now. You're aware of it, and people are shameless about it, completely shameless. You now have a very aware, say, whoa, wait a minute. They just see me as the foil, just being used for half-truths. There's no interest in the world. I've realized that, of course, but it's just completely endemic on this planet. That's what happens. And so you become very clear about that, and then you're not happy about it, that is for sure. It's kind of like, here we come to torture you again, and you realize it is torture, but their intent, they have no intention whatsoever of ending it. None. Again, the interest in truth in this world is really interest in half-truth, for the most part. There are some exceptions, and hopefully some of you watching this are exceptions to that, there are those who have escape velocity going, which escape velocity means you're able to look at the content of your own mind and carefully notice and examine it and be aware of it on an ongoing basis and begin to have insights and in the mood of repentance. That's what escape velocity is. And there's some of you, I've noticed there's some here that watch the videos that are able to do that. They're able to make their own, have their own insights, to actually experience breakthroughs and say, wow, I see this, whoa. It's like, holy cow. And I say the mood of repentance is super important. It's an overall attitude. It's just, take the blow. Just keep going on with your life and don't fly off the handle. Don't get upset. And don't try to do anything great or not great. Or just stay smooth. Stay sober, calm, reflective, humble, all this stuff. Because the good part of seeing this is it's a big upside to the insights, really. Huge upside. One thing is, you're not going to get tricked coming into the world again. not as a guru, not as a musician. Those are the two of the big ones. Or politician, or leader, or social change advocate, or anything like that. It's all a trick. Totally. It's kind of like inviting, certain people into a country club, saying, okay, so they can meet a quota and say, okay, we have this number of people here and this number of people here, and now we have a, equitable system or something. But half-truths say, okay, we've got some people here, we've got truth, people speaking truth, and then we've got all the people, many people speaking lies, and then now we've got this combination, which is, of course, really nothing but a lie, a big lie. This world is really nothing but a big lie. That is the truth. Big lie. That we don't see. We don't see. And we think we're making progress. No, we're not. Making progress towards a half-truce is no progress at all. And the ego disguises this level confusion of, yeah, we're making progress. We're going towards our objective. But the objective is nothing. There is no such thing as a half-truth. It's a lie. It's all a lie. So lies have no value. So we're not making any progress towards value whatsoever. But through definitional tricks, we think, you know, we're progressing towards, you know, towards trying to value half-truths. But it all keeps falling apart, and it's an impossibility. So just have to, you know, keep letting this sink in. It's super heavy. It's my Superbowl, as it were. It's better than the Superbowl. You don't have to come back to this world. You're letting this, you know, settle in and go as you go along. Then you realize, wow. Under no circumstances do you come back to this world unless you are an actual avatar, and you would know that, so that you don't follow some avatar into this world, because there might be a fake avatar, might be someone who's seduced by the guru role here and said, I need many disciples to come with me into this world and help me in my no. Stay away from that. You can get some very charismatic guru types coming into this world, and they could easily pull a whole bunch of other people into this world with them, thinking they're coming here to set the world straight with truth and all this kind of stuff. And you get suckered and played for that, you know, again. And they're getting played also. Their desire to be seen as a great savior is, they got deceived. The real gurus have no desire, like Anand and Mama, have no desire whatsoever for anything. Didn't have any desire to play the role of a savior or a guru or anything like that. None. Those are the only ones that are actually trustworthy, who don't have any desire, who say everything's completely perfect already. I don't have any. They see everything as completely already perfect. There's no need to do anything. But that there's a call, there's a call for them to appear somewhere. So they appear, but they're not attached to their appearance at all, nor are they attached to their historical significance at all. No attachment to their legacy at all. Those are the only ones that can really handle this situation here. To those who come into this world who want to be historic and all this kind of stuff, you know, I want to be historically great guru, I want to, you know, they're being deceived, they're being played. They're being played by what I call the goddess or the ego. They're being played, they're being fooled. They're just being a foil for lies to amalgamate then a half-truth out of that. And they certainly can pull a lot of people into this world with them, for sure. Thinking that they're part of some great revival of truth, you know, and stuff. No. They're being played. They're being played for fools. The situation's way more deeper than that. Way deeper. This whole half-truth situation is just an incredible deception. And we have to see through it. Now, of course, in miracles, I still say that is can be a tremendously helpful and clarifying document and consideration. I think Jesus did a fabulous job there. Just tremendous, if you use it correctly, because he points out this whole situation about half-truths. It bears very heavy teaching. It can also be taken superficially, too. But if you really get into it, you begin to get a real education, which leads to eventually seeing this whole deal with half-truths, seeing the continuity problem as the only problem you really have, and then freeing yourself from any desire or being tricked to actually incarnate again. That's real liberation. So, you really have to, as Anand Maimaya said, as you play the piano, so you hear the tune. The piano's there, but it's how you play it that you're going to hear the tune. So, I mean, the teachings are there. It doesn't mean necessarily you're going to get it, you know, get the real intent and get truly get liberated. it's easy to take it superficially too, if that's what you want. So there has to be ability to look on the positive side, the sunny side, without losing track of also the side of seeing, wow, don't want to get tricked like that again, for sure. And the fact that all the suffering was because you were tricked. You know, you were deceived by, you know, the arch deceiver, which is really just an expression, a projection of our own desire to deceive ourselves and deceive God, actually. It's the only projection of our desire to deceive God coming back at us in the form of the ego and, you know, brutally deceiving us out of fear of the continuity issue. Again, the whole situation hinges on how much leverage the ego has over you. And to the extent you do not accept or recognize that you have a continuity problem, the ego has leverage over you. And then it will sell you on these distortions. It will find a way to sell you on them. Even though you have sales resistance, it will still find a way to sell you on them. And it'll say, oh, there's some great guru or guruess coming into the world, and you're going to have to help them spread the gospel of salvation around the whole world, and you'll be able to provide the great music that will attract billions of people, and you'll save millions of people, and all this spiel, you know, kind of stuff, and you'll fall for it. You'll fall for it. Just say, don't waste your breath, ego. I'm not coming into the world, period. So, don't waste your time. Oh, but you're not compassionate. Don't waste your time. Only problem I have is a continuity problem. I don't have an ego problem. I don't have a world savior problem. I don't have an evangelical problem. I don't have a gospel problem. I only have a continuity problem. And that's the only problem that anyone has. So I'm working on that at that level, strictly. That's all I'm working on, say, is the continuity issue. I'm not working at the level of music. I'm not working at the level of gurus or world, say, you know, evangelization, spreading the good word. I'm not working on that at that level. I'm just working at strictly at the level of the continuity issue and the resolution of that and nothing else. That is your safety, okay? That's your safety net. Everything else, thoughts about things have no value. Thoughts about saving the world has no value. No value. No value there. Only the vision of oneness has value, period. And until you have the vision of oneness, you're not entertaining any offers for anything else, period. I say that's your safety. Got to have that. So I'm a stickler for that because through my own experience, I have every right to be a stickler for it, for sure. Because you can be misled through good intentions and compassion, etc., that you get totally exploited. That's how you get exploited. Severely exploited. And then thrown away like a useless, you're disposable, you're completely disposable. From the ego standpoint, you're totally disposable. You know, just your only interest in ego is get these half-truths, get us to believe, everyone to believe in half-truths, which are no truths at all, none whatsoever. It's like saying, what part of truth is a lie? There's no part of truth that's a lie. So how can you have a half-truth? You can't. You cannot have a half-truth. It's so simple. And yet, we will go lifetime after lifetime after lifetime, not even recognizing or seeing this. Why? Out of fear of the continuity issue. The more you dispel the fear of the continuity issue, the easier it is to see through all this stuff. All of it. The most difficult stuff, we think, oh, all these blocks, I'll never be able to see through. Work on the continuity problem, and these things like crumble. All these blocks crumble like dust. You say, oh, it's a piece of cake. It's not difficult. I was just afraid the ego would abandon me if I saw through this, and I would have no problems at all, and that's freaking me out. Remember, the Holy Spirit will not abandon you. Just because the ego takes off, and the ego says, oh, there's no more ego, so you have to go, you know, no more problems, everything vanishes, now you're in reality. It doesn't happen that way, because the Holy Spirit says, no, I'm here. The ego's vanished, fine, but I'm here, and I'm in my imagination, I'm holding an imagination, everything, the whole universe, okay? And I know you have a continuity problem, so I'm making sure that you have this universe to see as oneness, smoothed out oneness, so you're reminded of reality. So the Holy Spirit holds the whole universe in place for you. The ego, gone, doesn't matter. So we feel threatened that if the ego disappears, the universe will disappear. Not true. Holy Spirit holds the entire universe in its imagination, and, okay? And it will not abandon you until the continuity problem is resolved for you. That's what Jesus has said, and that's a fact. I believe in that. I absolutely trust in that, because reason tells me this is exactly right. And our fear is the abandonment of the ego. When we see through all its tricks, it'll disappear on us, right? And then we'll have nothing that's generating all these problems in this form-based universe and all this stuff. Wrong. The Holy Spirit keeps the whole universe in its imagination, and the potential problematic nature that is inherent in seeing that, but that we don't experience any problems. Everything's smoothed out for us. And that reminds us of reality. You see, everything is smoothed out, oneness, sameness. And then that resolves the continuity issue for us. And then we don't need this universe at all, actually. Don't need form at all. Absolutely not. We're able to know spaciousness is all there is. Pure spaciousness is all there is, really. A whole different situation than we're used to. So again, the continuity problem is the absolute linchpin key to your salvation. No question about it. These insights, that they will come. Just let them come and say, okay, great. And then go right back to working on the continuity issue. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I accept it totally. I accept it totally. I know the Holy Spirit backs it up. Absolutely. And again, in order to have a remedy for something, you have to have a potential problem. And the Holy Spirit keeps this potential problem of form for us, so it can apply the remedy of smoothed out oneness to that. So it's not going to drop it's not going to drop the universe in its imagination. Even though the ego has bailed, fine. Holy Spirit won't drop it. So no worries there, you see? No worries there. That enables us then to see through the deceit of the ego to the ultimate extent. Ultimately, I would say. Maybe I have some more insights to come, probably. I'll let this one smooth out first. it's a big one for sure. When you realize why you got suckered into coming here in the first place, and now you see through it and you realize you're not going to get suckered again, that pretty much means you're not going to be taking another birth here, right? At this point, I don't quite see that. You know, I'm still suffering from this. My God, you know, what an utterly diabolical thing, you know, to go through this. Totally diabolical, horrible. What a horrible place this world is. The mentality of it all, you know, the mentality. All those forms are there, kind of really is one level, is neutral, but it's our purpose, our mentality, our desire, and our projected desire, and the ego and all that, which puts us through hell, really hell. This world is really diabolical hell, no question about it. And to realize that you actually got suckered into diabolical hell is not a pleasant realization, really. It's wow. Not pleased by it at all, for sure. No, nobody's pleased by it. And the upside is you won't do it again. So, but still, having done it is not a fun thing at all. And having realized it's just all a dance of deception, and that everybody is just, you know, doing that dance of deception, of belief in half-truths here, for the most part, except those who have escape velocity, the rare ones who really are taking a look at it, you know, in depth, taking a look at suffering, taking a look at death, taking a look at impermanence. Whoa, this is all bogus. You know, there's something totally, they realize there's something totally bogus about the whole situation. Those are the rare ones who are fortunate that they're going to be able to. The mood of repentance will carry as a stream that carries them, a great river really carries them to the ocean of realization. When they realize that they hate this world, it's bogus, it's completely deceptive, and we're getting played for fools here, and you know, that's a good thing. That's a great thing to be able to see that, but they have to continue on with this mood of repentance, sober, humble, being able to absorb these heavy insights without getting bitter about it, you know. Have a sense of humor, just, okay. Forgive yourself, you know, because it's really so cleverly cultivated our folly. The projection. Projection is such a powerful blindness. Incredible blindness. We blame God for super powerful projection, and that just holds us, captive. But pragmatically, beyond that, from a pragmatic standpoint, it's the continuity issue that keeps us bound at this point. See, at this point, it's the continuity issue. It started out as projection, but it's easy to admit that we use projection, but now we're stuck with this continuity issue, that's very severe. Very severe. But it's completely solved by the Holy Spirit. So, no worries at all. We're saved. But we have to, recognize that that's the only problem we have. We don't have an egoic problem. We have a continuity problem. And saying we don't have an egoic problem means if the ego vanishes, we don't have a problem with it. That's the threat the ego uses on us. That's going to vanish on us. It's going to leave us. It hates us. It can't stand our company because we're seeing these insights. It says, I can't stand your company anymore. Fine, ego. Goodbye. Goodbye. Goodbye, Lamig. Lamig is like a harsh, cold, noxious wind, very terrible wind. Lamig. Goodbye, Lamig. Goodbye. No auf Wiedersehen, not till we meet again. We're not meeting again. Get lost. So, you have to not be intimidated by that. And it's super intimidating, no question about it. Because the ego says, okay, all problems will vanish immediately forever, right now. And you say, whoa, not so fast. But now you just say, well, we'll see, whatever. It's not going to happen anyway because I've got the continuity problem, thank God. I've got this continuity problem. And thank God that God realized this, I have a continuity problem, and has given the remedy for it, so I won't be without problem. I'll have a problem, and it's a big one. It encompasses the whole universe. And the solution is a universal solution. So, go. I'm not scared, ego, by all your talk, all your bluster. But it's really cruel deception, this world is. This world can be, based, might as well title this world Cruel Deception. Don't call it Gaia, planet, mother, whatever, Mother Earth, all this stuff. No, it's Cruel Deception, is what the name of this planet is, really. Very cruel deception. Extreme cruel deception. ECD. I don't know, Crud, planet crud, cruel, rancid, utter deception. Yeah, that's planet crud. We live on planet crud, cruel, rancid, utter deception. We live on a cruddy planet. We live in a cruddy universe, actually. A very cruddy universe. Trying to establish something called half-truth as the new reality and dweller forever. Spiritual pride saying, we're greater than God. God only has truth. We have both truth and lies. We have this new amalgamation called half-truths. Look how great we are. We're superior. God is nothing. We've forgotten all about God. See, that's the path we've been on. So, very cruddy path. Cruel, rancid, utter deception. So getting off the cruddy path is a very good thing, but realizing you've been on a cruddy path is like yuck, yuckadoodles. It's terrible, not nice. But once you get to this point, it's not so bad at all, really. Just kind of like a little bit uncomfortable, a little bit sad, regretful, a little bit regretful, but just a tinge of that stuff. Not much. It's not like you drink it down. It's not bad. It's just got these tinges. Like it's like drinking stale water or something. It's like, that didn't taste so good. But it's okay. It's like kind of like that. But how are you going to get to freshness if you don't recognize that you haven't been in freshness? You've been in cruddiness. Cruel, rancid, utter deception. Cruel, raw, utter deception. That's another way. Cred. Cruel, raw, utter deception. Yeah, maybe that's even better. Cruel, raw, utter deception. We've been in this path of cruddiness, this world of cruddiness. Pursuing belief in half-truth as superior to truth. Plain and simple. And then doing that over and over and over because of the fear of the continuity issue, which we haven't, we're so unaware of this. The real gospel is concerning the continuity issue in the Holy Spirit. That's the actual gospel of salvation, is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the key to salvation, really, because it has the capacity to hold the entire universe in its imagination once the ego is vanished, and bless it with a vision of oneness, totally smoothed out, sameness, oneness, bliss, to bless it all. That's what saves us. The Holy Spirit is what actually saves us. So the real gospel is to be aware of the Holy Spirit, actually. And then it guides you to recognizing the problem that it solves is the continuity problem. I mean, my past started out when I began to become aware that there was such an entity or intelligence, a blessing, as the Holy Spirit. I gradually realized there's something that's totally aware of the entire situation and has this solution to it. I didn't know what it was. I could call it whatever you want to. But there is, I began to become aware of that. That was 1978. And gradually become aware that its remedy is designed for the continuity problem. Gradually become aware of that. So really, and who created the Holy Spirit? God did. Which is, the Holy Spirit is a blessing of God, blessing Spirit. And to give a reminder. So there's this blessing of reminder of reality. So it's God that actually saves us in the from the functionality standpoint, in the functioning of the Holy Spirit, which is that which keeps, again, all of existence in its imagination so that we can experience it in a perfectly smoothed out way, which reminds us of reality, so then we can then drop the whole dream of imagination altogether and once again know what is. So nobody is left behind at all. Holy Spirit's there for everybody until the last one of us finally accepts the resolution of the continuity problem. And our role is simply to accept the resolution of the continuity problem. That's it. That's the only role we have, actually. Jesus made that very clear. Your only responsibility is to accept, you know, your salvation, the vision of oneness, vision of Christ, as he puts it. Christ, again, refers to oil. Oil is a smoothed out, smoothness, sameness, right? When you anoint something with oil, it's all smoothed out, sameness, no crystallization. It's a metaphor for vision of oneness, healed perception, pure spaciousness. It's a reification, reified metaphor for zero dimensionality, smoothed out spaciousness, vision of oneness. So all we have to do is accept that. That's it. And once we do that, then we're really immune from all the tricks of the ego, you know, all the self-aggrandizing, glamorous tricks of the ego, which it will keep using on us until we're immune from it, for sure. And again, the mood of repentance is necessary because you know the ego is going to try to trick you again, for sure. No question. So he's like, hey, don't get too puffed up. Don't get too puffed up. Stay humble. The ego already had me working on some artwork, some fabulous artwork, and it was like, wow. And the ego says, hey, you got to show people this artwork. You know, you can't, you know, not do that. I mean, look how great, what a great artist you could be, and all that stuff. And I said, ah, man, more tricks, you know. The ego tries to, again, get us to do great art and then say, hey, people got to see this art, you know. And before you know it, you've fallen into, you know, this grand deception. Whether it's a musician or artist or combination thereof, or combination guru, artist, musician, lover, you know, all these roles, right? Oh, you're a great lover, you know, great compassionate lover, artist, musician, and guru. Oh, you've got to come save the world, you know. Absolutely. You get these potent combinations that the ego uses on you, try to deceive you. Oh, you're some great multitasker. You can do it all. The world needs you. No, your only responsibility is to accept the vision of oneness, which is the resolution of the continuity problem. That's it. Only then should any other thing be considered as far as helping, whatever, doing whatever. That only then are you safe from, you know, the grand deception. Only after you've abided in that state for quite some time, so you're just totally familiar with the smoothed outness. Only then you will know when you're totally immune. But we're a ways away from that, so there's no reason to say that we're immune. We're not totally immune. We still have this vulnerability to the grand deception, to the grand diabolical deception that we have foisted upon ourselves through projection, through desire to be greater than God and projection, and ultimately now continuity problem arises. So stay in the mood of repentance. This advice, I'm finding it's the right advice. If you have a great insight, acknowledge it. Let it settle in. Say, okay, but I'm still very sober, very serious, very contemplative, knowing that I'm not saved yet. Just because you're close or on the way doesn't mean you're immune. You're not immune. You're not saved yet. You know, I got tipped off in a dream last night to avoid something today. Well, I was tempted to go to the fan fest, giant fan fest. And I was shown in a dream, you know, where that's going to lead to. And it's very bad. And I said, well, not going to do it. Not going to do it. And instead, I had this tremendous breakthrough. You know, so that just shows you. But the temptation was there. You know, not for the Holy Spirit arranging certain things in a certain way, I probably would have gone. So it would have been a very big mistake to go to that. And I was shown in the dream what the various one thing leads to another, led to another, led to another, and before you know it, I was in big trouble. So stay away. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit block your way. Stay away from frivolous excitation and people and stuff. The world is in a coma. You know, we're in a comatic situation, actually. Planet coma. Planet cruddy coma. This is really cruddy coma. Planet cruddy coma is how we call it. Yeah, where are you from? I'm from the planet cruddy coma. Cruel, raw, utter deception. Where everyone's in a comatose state. Very comatose state. Planet cruddy coma. Because the awakening is the vision of oneness. Vision of oneness, absolutely. And only that is the awakening. That's the solution to the continuity issue we have. So all this other stuff that you see in the world, all this boosterism, spiritual boosterism, forget it. Forget it. It's not about making everything one here. No, the Holy Spirit will show you everything at smoothed out oneness, totally irrespective of what's going on the planet. We don't have to do anything whatsoever to make it that way. It's the Holy Spirit that shows us this vision. It's already there. It's always been there. So it's nonsense to be running around trying to make the world a better place. You're being diabolically deceived when you're doing that. Being played. In the game of half-truths. The ego will say, look, there's all these people trying to make this world a better place. And there's all these people trying to make it a terrible place. We put them together, and we've got this new half-truth, which is superior reality. That's the game that's being played. You're being played here. So don't go running around trying to trump what a great world this is, and we're making it better and all the time, and et cetera, et cetera, turning into a paradise, blah, blah, blah. No. Say, I only have one problem. That's the continuity problem. The Holy Spirit has a solution to the continuity problem, which is the vision of oneness. And my only responsibility is to accept that vision of oneness. Only the vision of oneness has value. Be adamant about that. Only the vision of oneness has value. I mean, all sorts of people ask, and none of my mom, hey, Mom, I want to do this. I want to make hospitals. I want to do charity. I want to make compassion. I want to help the world. She says, don't waste your time. It's a waste of time. I want to be a great political leader. You know, don't waste your time. It's a waste of time. That's not it. She says, that's not it. Just be quiet be quiet, but basically be in the mood of repentance and contemplate and repent and move towards the vision of oneness. That's it. That's the advice you're going to get from any teacher, legit teacher. That's the advice you're going to get. People say, huh? But we want to use you for, you know, you could be used as a great figurehead to do this. And it's just like no interest. Just sit there like no interest. With just, and the people around here are like, they're really like kind of in a bummed out, like, how can we get her to, you know, support our charity and our you know, our healing of the world work and all this stuff? How can we get them? They can't figure out how, got to figure out how to do this. And they never did. And they were all bummed out by it, actually. They said, it's a great failure. We failed. Well, how can we fail? She's zero interest in any of that. Zero interest. It really bothered people. A great burden on their minds. Like, whoa, what's going on? We're not worthy. They felt, we're not worthy. We're just worthy that she'd want to do all this stuff. No, not true at all. I had nothing to do with worthiness. Just telling us what the real remedy, the direction we got to go in is, what the actual remedy is. See, the East is much more familiar with associating with people, gurus, and all this stuff. But where the West, we're more used to universities, books, studying, all this stuff. So Jesus gave this format, A Course in Miracles, which spelled it out for us in book form, which is what the people of the book want. I mean, with the Judeo-Christian tradition, it's really people of the book, okay? The Indian, Tibetan Indian, you know, subcontinent tradition is not so much that. It's tradition of satsang darshan, of actual enlightened beings here in the world. That's their tradition. So she didn't write anything. She just sat there and people come see her and they can relate. They can relate to that. We, Judeo-Christian tradition, cannot relate to that so well. They want to read, you know, the Talmud, you know, the Torah, the Talmud, the Bible. There's a long tradition of studying books. So Jesus gave us this great book, A Course in Miracles. Man, I studied it like every day, like for 15 years. I was completely immersed in studies. Finally, it became totally too much. As far, I couldn't stand words anymore. I had enough of books and words. And I found I was getting in the way. The whole structure of words and all this stuff was actually getting in the way of the true simplicity of the message. And Jesus said, look, the purpose of this book is to make this book unnecessary. You got to go beyond it. And that's what happened. I couldn't tolerate it anymore. And I stopped reading books. After I finished, I never read books hardly ever again. And I did read Journey Beyond Words by Dr. Brent Haskell, which was like a really great summation of it that simplified it. And then I went from there, just worked internally with own, you know, clarification, just within my own mind, clarifying it all. That's been like 20 years. Actually, I've been doing that for 20 years. It's pretty much stopped A Course in Miracles like 1993, Journey Beyond Words for a year, 94, and since then, nothing. Just all internal simplification, clarifying, boil it down to its essence, simplify. 20 years of that, from 94 to 2014. That's 20 years straight of not reading virtually anything at all. Just continually working in my own mind to simplify, you know, that's it. And pretty much I had like 20 years of intense study of books before that. Even before A Course in Miracles came out, I was studying intensely spiritual books since like about 1974 through 1994, so 20 years there, and then 20 years of no books. That's a good career path. And then prior to 74, I had been very much focused on the overall spiritual path and importance. But I had not gone into super intense reading. I got into super intense reading for about 20 years. Just nonstop, super intense. Money, I'd buy books, come home, read, nonstop for 20 years. And after that, nonstop contemplation for 20 years. And eventually, you know, that wears away, you know, delusion, and you become oriented towards the continuity issue. Is the only problem that I have, actually. It's the only problem there is. There is no other problem. That's a fact. All this duplicity, it's only held in place by the fear of the continuity issue, the fear of the ego. If we want to get rid of it, all problems will vanish instantly. And that is our fear, actually. That's our great dread. Everything else is pales by comparison. We're not afraid of death by comparison. I've seen how many people have died. You see them die, they're not that scared of it at all. They just kind of go to sleep and don't wake up. But they actually say, no, I'm not scared of this at all. I'm looking forward to it. It's not that big of a fear. What we're really afraid of is all our problems vanishing. That's what we're terrified of. We're afraid of the universe vanishing. That's the continuity issue. And we have the ability to make the universe vanish for sure. Because it's all our own imagination based on projection. And we can give that up in an instant. We can give it up in an instant. Any instant, as a matter of fact. So we're scared, oh my God. And the God says, don't worry, I created the Holy Spirit as a blessing. It won't give it up. Even if you give it up, the Holy Spirit will maintain it. Because in case you have a continuity issue, which of course you will. So that's the safety net. We have a safety net. That's the great gospel, great good news. We have a safety net. Even if we decide to give it all up, it will still remain. The Holy Spirit will keep it there for us. Because certainly, we'll have instant second thoughts. Oh, wait a minute, I don't want to be, you know, I don't want to be completely without even the potential for problems. Can I at least have at least the faint potential of problems? And God says, sure, Holy Spirit will give that for you. And even though you have this perfectly smooth out oneness, there's still this faint, plausible potential for problems in the very nature of form itself, right? Of nature of perception itself, all right, has the faint plausible possibility of problems in it. So that reassures us. We say, oh, great. As long as that's there, I feel comfortable. And then we experience this smoothed out oneness. So the remedy is wonderful. And just we need to just be clued into it. The whole spiritual path is just getting clued into what the situation actually is. Because the ego is so frantic to keep us from not being clued into it. Because it says, oh, you're gonna be with, everything's gonna disappear. Oh, it's too much for you. No, ego, I've got a continuity problem. God knows about it. The Holy Spirit's was created to deal with this, and so everything's fine. No worries. Just get into that. The ego has so many distractions and lies and half-truths and deceptions. It feels like you could go wading through that swamp forever. You know? So the Holy Spirit has to save you time. You'll learn how to generalize properly. And you'll learn to recognize, whoa, and move your contemplation up to a higher level. So you see everything down, all these tricks, all the same tricks, all the same. It's just, you know, half-truths. You begin to save yourself time. Initially you think it's going to take forever. Really, that's a bummer. You know, think, oh my gosh, I see the path I have to take, it looks like it'll take forever. And then gradually you save time, and you're able to, you recognize that, oh, these are all just grains of sand, I don't need to count every one of them. When you lose the fear of the continuity issue, then you stop, you say, oh, I don't have to count all those grains of sand. That was just a delaying tactic I was using, thinking that it's important that I differentiate each grain of sand. You know, this one's slightly different than this one. That's all a delaying tactic based on the continuity fear. As you lessen the continuity fear, then you just easily become smart, way smarter, and say, no, it doesn't matter. Differences in grains of sand doesn't matter at all. It's totally, the Holy Spirit will smooth them all out has already smoothed it all out perfectly. I don't have to catalog anything. Don't have to catalog anything. Nobody has to catalog anything. And the path is very interesting in that you never quite think you got it. You know, it's always a little different than you thought. And it always seems to be a little bit out of your grasp. You know, you never quite, you say, oh, I don't quite have it. I've never felt that I've quite had it. Because ultimately, you know, it's the Holy Spirit that smooths it all out. And nothing matters to the Holy Spirit at all, as far as there doesn't see any differences. Where there are no real differences, doesn't see any. So it's easy for the Holy Spirit to show a vision of complete smoothed out oneness. But for us, from where we're coming from, with the fear of the conduit issue, we can't get it. We don't really get it. We don't really get it. We might get glimpses, we might conceptualize those glimpses, we might be very glib and charismatic in presenting it, but we don't really get it. We have to actually abide in this vision. That's our responsibility, just abiding in it. And knowing outside of that, we won't really get it. We'll be judging and thinking, comparing and categorizing and cataloging and thinking about things. Thinking about things are not our real thoughts at all. It's not our real thoughts at all. Our real thoughts have a tremendous effect, etc. But thinking about things is just spinning your wheels. It's just imaginary thought, really. Seasonably cool here today, which is kind of a shock. We're used to like 78 in January. Now it's like 60 or 58 or something. And take a while to just check in with yourself, you know. Just keep breathing. Keep breathing, say everything's okay. If you made it this far, I would say everything's okay, because the stratification is likely to start taking place, which is a positive thing. Just this very breakthrough I've had is a very positive thing for the world, actually. It shows you that there's something going on that's very helpful. And stratification is likely to take place, and it is possible to see through the whole situation. It is possible, and we do have this teaching of a continuity issue, and no valuing, netty, no valuing of these thoughts, but that is put in a very clear context. And all this stuff is possible now. It is possible. We're not completely bereft of help, really. How could I have gotten to this spot if we're all bereft of help? It's not really plausible, is it? Not really. You can make up a plausible case. The ego can always make a plausible case for anything, any lie, of course. But why waste time with that? The continuity problem is the only problem we have. We don't have a plausibility problem, we have a continuity problem. So whether the ego can make a plausible case or not is irrelevant. There's no value to it. There's no value to plausible cases. Only vision of oneness has value. See, just come back to that. Stops the ego in its tracks. Erases it, you know. The ego's writing on the blackboard, you just erase it. No value there. No value there. So maybe this is part one of the StuporBowl special, the alternative StuporBowl special here on planet... Crud, comatose crud, planet crud coma, to coma, crud coma, the crud coma planet crud coma, CC, planet CC, crud coma. We're having a StuporBowl on planet crud coma, where everybody practices being cruddy, cruddily comatose together, as one. We all agree as one in half-truths, as if agreeing in one. And half-truths is going to establish them as the new reality. That's the ego's plan. Kurt course, the ego knows that that doesn't ever work, but it's a good delaying tactic, right? A nice goal to hold out there to delay, as we hopefully the ego thinks that sufficient delay will get us to forget reality altogether. We'll just be so dismayed, we'll be so disheartened, so dispirited, we'll just give up. Well, guess what? You can't give up. That's what I found out in my suffering. It's not possible to give up. You try and you can't. You can't give up on truth. You know, we are truth. Truth is truth. And there's no separation from truth. So it's impossible to give up on truth. And so the ego's plan doesn't work. Will never work. But it can certainly delay us and delay us and delay us and delay us and delay us. And so the Superbowl on planet Crud Coma is a big delaying tactic for sure. So this is an alternative. You have alternative programming, folks. How about that? No excuses. No excuses. Planet Crud Coma. Cruel, raw, utter deception. Where we're in a comatose state. A comatic world. A very comatic world, actually. To coin a word, probably, comatic. So everyone's going to celebrate their comatic condition by watching the Super Bowl. I'm trying to come up with some alternative, you know. Definitely. It doesn't help anybody, really, at all. So some alternative to that. There's so much pressure, social pressure. You know, it's just like, you're not watching? What's wrong? What's the matter with you? It's like having a flip phone. I still have a flip phone. And somebody looked at it yesterday and said, "My God, that's a dinosaur." And I said, actually, I'm into retro style. It's the new cool thing is retro style. And that's why I've got it, you know. And he said, "Wow, that's a good one. Very good. Very good. Come back on that." Actually, I'm just avoiding the dumb phones so I can smarten up. So flip phone is the new smartphone, actually, folks. The old flip phone is the new smartphone because it enables you to avoid the dumb phone so you can smarten up. Avoid all the comatic content on the dumb phones so you can keep smartening up. Avoid the cruddy comatic content on the television, on the movie screen, on the internet, on the dumb phone so you can smarten up. So be retro. You know, if I have any style at all, maybe it'll be a retro style, actually. Really, you can't avoid style. If you have form, you have style. Period. So you can't avoid it. And all these people are trying desperately to look like they have no style, and they're like the most stylish people of all. You look at the hippies. I mean, nobody was more stylish than the hippies, and the hippies were rebelling against all the style in the world. You know, no, we don't got style. You know, well, they got the dreads, they got the beads, they got the shirts, they got the hippie garb, you know, they got the walk, the attitude. I mean, they were like completely styling. So, I mean, for me, any style you want to style, retro style is actually cool. Go with the flip phone, the Motorola flip phone. If you can find them. I mean, the people are amazed. It still works. Huh, that's weird. We had planned obsolescence for those, only supposed to work 4 years. What's the matter? Something strange here. That's what I got. We went into a store that sells these, and they said, "How come that phone's still working? It's not supposed to still be working." I said, "Why?" And they said, "Well, they build them with planned obsolescence. They build them to fail after about 4 years, actually." I said, "Yeah, I've heard that." And they said, "Is that true?" They said, "Yeah, absolutely, it's true. We know about that. It's they do make them fall apart intentionally. So you'll get a new phone." And so they're very surprised that that phone's still working. Wow, that's amazing. Yeah, but the pressure's severe to get a dumb phone, isn't it? To go along with the cruddy comatic program here. cruddy chromatic brainwashing indoctrination on this planet to believe in half-truths, the goal of half-truths, which is the holy grail of the ego. Absolutely, it's the holy grail of the ego. You gotta admit, this is better than the Super Bowl, right? Absolutely, it's way better. Way better than those cruddy chromatic talking heads and those gladiators, you know, cruddy chromatic gladiators running into each other, and the howling comatose chromatic fans there, God, it's just cruddy, isn't it? Cruel, raw, utter deception is all it is. Who needs that? When it's better to contemplate and realize, hey, be reassured that I can be free. I never have to go into this form-based, cruddy chromatic place ever again. Ever again. You're free, 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 and free. True liberation. Not all this, demolishing of the checks and balances on this planet that kept the whole deception somewhat in check and at bay. See, there are checks and balances here. There were, as a matter of fact, that enabled us to at least contemplate, spend some of our effort towards liberation. But what happened was the ego made an all-out push and to demolish those checks and balances. It's a social, they engaged in social engineering, demolished traditional society, actually, traditional roles, traditional society, under the guise of liberation. And that actually destroyed the checks and balances on this planet, which is why the planet is in actually total crisis mode. Even though they think they're in total success mode. That is the crisis mode. They think they're succeeding in establishing a total unified worshiping of half-truths, which is failure, utter failure, catastrophic failure. So they're succeeding in catastrophic failure, and they keep thinking that's a success. That's delusion, based on the fear of the continuity issue. They're afraid to see through this delusion because the ego threatens it'll leave them. So if you're aware of the Holy Spirit, you're not fooled by this. So the awareness of the Holy Spirit on this planet is super important. And again, it can go by other names too. Grace of God. The Maha Shakti, the grace of God. The true Holy Spirit, the voice of reason. All these things. And the blessing of God. And I don't know, every tradition has a way of referring to this, okay? It's not important. But the fact is, it's there. And so the checks and balances on this planet kept our weaknesses in check. You see, we all have very much vulnerabilities, Achilles' heel, and weaknesses because of the leverage of the ego. So the checks of the traditional society, checks and balances, kept the ego somewhat in check. It couldn't exploit us to the ultimate extent. It could exploit us, but not to the extent that it really wanted to get us to all worship half-truths. But the ego has finally been able to, on this planet, to get rid of those checks and balances. It's kind of like, like a president. You don't want a president to be too powerful. You want checks and balances on the president. In case the president turns out to be a real egoic operator of the ego, And so you think, well, if we gave the president more power, they'd be able to get more done. But on the other hand, that could lead to getting a lot of stuff done we don't want to get done. So let's have a president that's not so powerful, charismatic, whatever, and can't get so much done. Make sure we have checks and balances on the presidency. Very important. Very important, actually. Those have been demolished. Okay, that's just one example. Checks and balances between the two genders, of male and female, in the roles. Super, super important. Those have been demolished, actually. Demolished. And that's what's led to this attempt to unify worship of the ego, half-truths. Whole goal of half-truths in this world, which is again catastrophic failure, which everyone now believes is ultimate success. Now, and when it doesn't succeed, that's when the real brutality, the cruel, raw, utter deception and devastation will start taking place. As people get very angry, say somebody's holding out, let's get them. So the checks and balances were super important, which is why I was so adamant. And as they're being destroyed, I said, this is a disaster. This is going to result in utter disaster on this planet. You cannot remove those checks and balances. those are super essential. And the world decided they're going to just bulldoze them. Bulldoze them, yeah. All right, so we've been taping for, I don't know how long. I can only make a 2-hour edit on YouTube video editor. Each video segment here is 20 minutes long. My camera only takes, so what I do, I upload all the files. Let's say like it's a 2-hour video, that'll be 6 20-minute files. And then I edit them together in YouTube editor and then publish it as a video. But all, YouTube editor only allows a 2-hour video. So I have to keep it under 2 hours. I may have to do part two because the Super Bowl lasts like, what, 4 hours or something. It's an extravaganza, a celebration of all the cruddy comatoseness of the world, isn't it? Really, it really is. It's just a celebration of everything that is so bad about this world, just a terrible. It's really a terrible, terrible event. The ego patting itself on the back and saying, look how much progress we've made here. Look how popular I am. The ego saying that, right? Look how the ratings we're getting. Yeah. So, all right. Very great. This will be the end of part one. Let's see. At some point I may do part two. Okay, and let's see if you can watch these instead of watching the Super Bowl. How about that? What a notion that is. Don't try to do both. Don't cheat it and say, okay, I'll do both. That's like buying into half-truths, you know. Last year, the 49ers in the Super Bowl, which is my team and the team of this area, and I didn't watch any of it. Didn't watch it. That's quite something, really, because everybody was watching. Didn't watch it. So, be easy not to watch this one, right? Absolutely. Done deal. So hopefully you're not watching it either. It's a great thing not to watch. Really. It's a great thing not to watch. Go retro. Go retro. I may do some retro styling just for fun. Why not? I don't know. But when you're thinking of style, think retro, because that's saying, hey, you know what, I'm gonna start limiting my, you know, involvement with this whole egoic deception. The future is nothing but egoic deception multiplied and expanded, and so I'm gonna sort of limit my exposure, because all these gadgets and stuff are designed to hook you into like this network, global network of cruddy comatoseness. That's what it's all about, actually. And so if you say, no, I'm kind of into retro right now, yeah. But don't overplay it, because of course people will, you look at that like, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Yeah, we're progressing. We're creating this huge success, you know. That's how we came here to this world, you know, all these techies. So we came here to this world and create the connect the whole world and it's great success, you know. And they don't realize it's drastic failure. Drastic failure, actually. Catastrophic failure. Worshipping half-truths is, you know, fail. Total fail. All right. Very great. Will there be a part two? You'll find out soon enough. But I can't edit it into this one. All right, that's it.